Thank you all for coming. So I want to talk about a very old problem and a very old paper. It's going to be 100 years old in 2 years. And this is joint work with Sang-won Bae at Kyung-hee University, Sergio Cabello in Ljubljana, my student Yoon Song, Fabian Steen in Bayreuth, and Sang-dok Yoon, who just finished his PhD at POSTEC. So, okay, let's go back to 100 years when this very famous problem was posed. So Ichi Kakeya, he was professor at Tohoku Imperial University, and he asked this question. If you have a ladder or a pen of length 1, and you want to rotate it once around itself, what's the smallest container in which you can do that? Right. So, as I said, the problem was posed in 1917. This is Kakeya here, and the problem was solved shortly afterwards by this gentleman here. The picture must be much older than this, Kyura Pal. And he showed that the solution is, in fact, the equilateral triangle of height 1. Right? If you want to turn a pen of length 1, and you want to be able to turn it around itself, the smallest convex shape in which this can be done is simply a rectangular triangle. The article is very interesting because he calls on this article, he already calls himself Julius Pal, but still with an accent. So Kyura Pal, he was Hungarian. Originally, this was his name, Kyura Pal. But he moved to Copenhagen in the early 1920s, I think. And then his name changed to Julius Pal, and at some point he also dropped the accent on the R. And the paper is written in German. So, actually I wanted to bring the paper, but of course I left it on my desk when I left my office. So, the problem is actually much more famous if you drop the word convex in the problem statement, right? If you allow for an arbitrary planar shape, and you ask how small can you make it, and you can still turn a pen of length 1 around itself, the answer is, there is no answer. There is no lower bound. Right? Bezikovic showed in 1928 that in fact you can make this area as small as you want, and then later it was shown that in fact there is a zero area set in which you can do it. Right? And this is a very famous result. There is a lot of related work. It has implications in all kinds of other areas, but it's not what I want to talk about. I want to go back to this paper by Kyura Pal from 1921. As I said, the paper was written by a Hungarian in Denmark in German. And on the last page of this paper, he poses some open problems. And among the open problems he poses is this one here, particularly interesting. So you have an oval C and you have a Halbstrahl A and, oh, sorry. This is a conjecture, right? So if you have a convex shape C, a planar compact convex shape C, capital C and another one, small c, and if it's true that for any possible orientation of little c, you can translate it inside capital C, does this mean there's also a continuous way to turn it around itself? Right, so clearly, the first statement is a necessary condition for the second. The question is it also sufficient? Right? For line segments, it's true. And it follows simply from the fact that the first statement implies that the width of the shape is at least 1 in every direction. And then you need a little bit more work. It's not entirely trivial. But it's true. And in fact, there is a proof in this paper for this statement for line segments. Right? So he asks, is it also true for arbitrary compact convex shape C? which in German are simply called oval. All right? And then, now it gets even more interesting. So this is already the last page of the paper, but then there is a footnote. And the footnote says, Zusatz bei der Korrektur. So that means this was added after the paper had been accepted and during the proof stage, right? When he made the final proofs to the manuscript before printing. And then it says, the question is, as I have been told by Mr. Harald Bohr, kindly, to be answered positively. Right? So apparently, Harald Bohr showed him a proof that this is in fact true. And there is then one line that says something about how Bohr proved that, and in fact he didn't do it the way that Pahl thought it could be done, but he uses elementary considerations about convex shapes. And that's all the information we have. Now Harald Bohr was, does anybody know Harald Bohr? He actually was a very productive mathematician, but he is somehow not as well known as his elder brother, Niels Bohr. But he is, in fact, he produced so much that when he died in the 1950s, somebody collected all his publications and made complete works of Harald Bohr. I was not able to find it myself, but I found a table of contents, and this result does not seem to have been published anywhere. I also could not find it anywhere else in the literature. So nobody seems to have revisited this question. So, what do you do? Well, you try to solve it yourself. So that's what I want to do today. Right, so let me introduce some notation. Because it's inconvenient to talk about little c and capital C all the time, let me talk about P and Q. So both of them are compact convex shapes in the plane, and I assume that the origin is in the interior of P, just for notational convenience. Now, I want to be able to rotate P, so I let P subscript theta denote the set P rotated by theta around the origin. Right, so you get something like this. P is turning. Right, then you want to be able to scale it. So if I scale it up by lambda, rather not get lambda times P theta. And now I wonder, well, if I translate it, can I fit it inside Q? And let me define for fixed angle theta, let lambda of theta be the larger scaling factor so that I can take this shape, so rotated and scaled, and it will still fit into Q by translation. Right? So it's as large as you can make it for this orientation. And translation you can choose freely as a function of theta. Right? So this defines a function in lambda. Okay. We will see in the near future that this function is indeed continuous. Once you have the right tools, this is very easy to see. And we will prove the following theorem. There is a continuous function that maps interval of angles, 0 to 2 pi, to vectors in R2, such that for every theta, you can rotate P, translate it to the maximum size, and then translate it by tau of theta, and then it will lie inside Q. Right? So here's a picture. The blue polygon is Q. The red triangle here is P. I've been plotting the largest possible copy of the triangle for every orientation at intervals of 1 degree, and well, then placed it inside Q. And you see indeed that this triangle, it rotates and at the same time scales and it translates continuously. Right. So that's what we want to prove, this theorem here. Now, how do I go about this? So the trick, maybe I should say this first. Right, so I said this is a generalization of Pahl's conjecture. In fact, this is quite immediate. So Pahl's assumption was that for any orientation of P, it will fit inside Q. So with my notation, that means P theta fits in Q for every theta. So that means that the larger scaling factor is always at least 1 for each theta. Right? And because, and by my theorem, there is this continuous function tau, so that lambda of theta, P theta plus tau fits inside Q. Well, then if you forget about the scaling here and simply place it, it will still fit, of course, because it's smaller. Right? So this is indeed a generalization of what Pahl conjectured and what Bohr proved 100 years ago. Okay, so this is a trick. You need to use the right parametrization of scaling, rotation, and translation. So the trick is that we encode the rotation and the scaling with two parameters, S and T, instead of lambda and theta. Right? So you take sine and cosine and you multiply them with lambda. That's your parameters S and T. Now, given four parameters, S, T, X, and Y, so that's this is a point in R4, you can associate with this four tuple, S, T, X, Y, an affine map, namely phi of these parameters. And it's defined as follows. So this map, if you apply it to a vector U, then it multiplies U with this matrix and then adds the vector X, Y. Right? So for every fixed STXY, this is the affine transformation. And in fact, if you look at the definition of SN2E, you realize this, of course, is simply a rotation by theta followed by a scaling by lambda. And then you translate by the vector XY. So what the operation does, if you apply it to the shape P, is you rotate, scale, and translate. Right? Now, how does this help us? Well, let's look at R4. Every point of R4 corresponds to one such affine transformation. And I define a subset F. So F is all those transformations that map P into Q. Right? So all those four tuples in R4, which if you interpret them as an affine map, if you apply it to P, you will go into Q. Right? So what is this set F? Well, it turns out it's a very nice set. It's, in fact, convex and compact in R4. And how do you see that? Well, take any point from P and take a half space or half plane that contains Q. Right? And then I define a half plane in R4, so a half space, HPH in R4, which is exactly those phi that map the point P into the half space H. Right? So I say this capital HPH, this is a half space. Well, you need to go back to the definition to see that. Right? So now here I'm plugging in a fixed point P. So that gives me here a fixed point P. So then you see this whole thing here is a linear function in the parameters S, T, X, and Y. Right? And what do I want? I want this point to lie in a fixed half plane. Right? So it's a linear constraint. It's a linear constraint in the four variables S, T, X, and Y. And that means it's a half space in R4. Right? And now my claim is F is simply the intersection of all of these. Right? Everybody sees that? Good. Then I'm not going to prove it. And one direction is trivial and the other one is simply convexity. Okay, but now there's an interesting special case. If P and Q are convex polygons, let's say P is an n-gon and Q is an n-gon, then in fact we can reduce ourselves to a much smaller set of PH. Right? Because now it suffices to argue that every corner of P must lie inside every half plane that's supported by an edge of Q. Right? You can think about now Q is an intersection of n half planes. And P, or an affine map of P, lies inside Q if every corner of P is mapped into every one of these half spaces, half planes. So now you get only n times m of these HPH. Right? So now the set F is simply the intersection of nm half spaces in R4. That's a convex polytope, right? A four-dimensional convex polytope. By the upper bound theorem, that means that the complexity of this object F here is big O of n squared m squared. Right? That's simply the general statement. A polytope defined by k half spaces has complexity big O of k squared in four dimensions. But in fact, these are not arbitrary half spaces. Right? They're defined by these points and these half planes in the plane. So they're not independent. And that means you can't actually achieve this complexity. Already 20 years ago, Agarwal, Armenta, and Sharia had proven that for this special shape, this special convex polytope, the complexity is actually only big M, m times n squared. So you win a factor m here. Surprisingly, it's not symmetric.
Can you explain what the complexity is?
The complexity of a polytope?
Yeah.
Well, so the polytope, you can think about it as a discrete object that has vertices, edges, two-dimensional faces, three-dimensional faces, and then the four-dimensional polytope. And the complexity is simply counting all these faces of all dimensions. Right? So in three dimensions, a polytope that's defined by n half spaces in three dimensions has linear complexity by Euler theorem, essentially. In four dimensions, it's quadratic in the number of half spaces. Right? But so the complexity of a polytope is simply the number of faces of all dimensions. Right? And so we know it's actually, for this object, it's actually at most this. So, now how does this help us? Now we have this nice encoding of rotations and translations, and rotation scalings and translations. We have this four-dimensional space, and we know something about the set of translations, so the set of mappings that put P inside Q. Now what I do next is I take F and I project it down onto the ST plane. Let me call the projection P for projection. Right, so remember, ST was simply lambda times cosine theta sine theta. Right, so a point ST lies in the projection of F, so it lies in P, if and only if there's a four-dimensional point in F that projects down on ST. What does that mean? Well, there must exist xy such that ST xy is in F. But that means that lambda p theta plus xy is in Q. Right? So projection is kind of an exists translation operation. Right? A point s, t will lie in P if and only if there is actually a translation xy such that lambda p theta plus this translation will be in Q. And so what does this mean? We now have a compact convex shape P in the ST plane. It contains the origin in its interior. Well, that's easy to see because the origin means scaling zero. If you scale P with zero, it will definitely fit in Q. Right? It's also compact because if you make P too large, it will definitely not fit inside Q. Right? So it's bounded. When P and Q are polygons, well, then P is a projection of a four-dimensional polytope So it's a convex polygon in the plane with, again, complexity at most m times n squared. Okay, so how do we use this? So here's a picture of the projection P. So this plane is now the ST plane. Right? Every point here is a pair ST. Now what does that mean? Fix a theta. Right? So fix a theta, that means cosine theta and sine theta are fixed. The only thing that varies now is lambda. So if you look at ST when lambda goes from 0 to infinity, but theta is fixed, well, you get a ray from the origin to infinity. And in fact, this angle here is exactly theta. Right? So for every theta, you get such a ray. Now, a point on this ray would be a lambda theta for this theta. And if you're inside P, it means lambda P theta plus xy fits in Q. Once you're outside P, it means you no longer fit. So what does it mean for this point here? Well, that's the largest lambda where you still fit inside Q. Right? So this point here is the point, well, the lambda value of this point is lambda of theta. Right? And now I have a proof here that lambda of theta is a continuous function. Because if you turn this ray around, this point goes along the boundary of a convex set. That's a continuous function. Because this point lies strictly in the interior. Right? So, I mentioned the paper by Agarwal, Armenta, and Sharia. So their question was actually, given two convex polygons P and Q, how large can you make P so that it will still fit inside Q? And the rotation was allowed. Right? So this can be solved with this projection shape P because, well, as we observed, this red point there on the boundary, that tells you how large can you make P, and it will fit inside Q with this orientation. So what's the answer to the question? How large can you make P? Yeah, it's a vertex of this P that is as far away from the origin as possible. Right? So you simply look at all the vertices and you take the one that has the largest lambda value. So it's as large as possible from the origin. So you will get a circle that contains this shape here. Okay? Now here's another interesting question. What is the largest copy of P that you can place in Q with every possible orientation? How do you solve that with my shape? P, well, now it's the largest circle around the origin that fits inside. So again, you can look at every edge and measure the distance to the origin. The minimum will be the answer to this question. Right. So these are already two interesting questions you can answer with this construction. But let's get back to our theorem. Right. So this is what we really wanted to prove. We claim there's a continuous function tau, should be tau, such that lambda theta p theta, so you, at every orientation, you make p as large as possible, and then you translate it with this function, and then it will fit inside Q. So this is my projection p in the ST plane. We already observed that the boundary somehow encodes this lambda of theta. So for every lambda of theta, p theta, I know actually which translations make it go inside Q. Right? Those are exactly the translations that project onto that boundary point. So what I really need to do is, I need to look at the function lambda of theta going around the boundary, and then I need to map this back into four dimensions. Right? What I want is a function tau xy such that stxy is in f and that depends continuously and on theta. So really one way to look at it is to say you take the boundary of this projection p and you need to continue continuously map it into four space so that it lies on the boundary of F. Right? So that's really the question. You have this convex shape in four dimensions, you project it down. Can you then map the boundary of the projection back up and get a closed curve? Right? And now in this picture, P, the projection is actually a polygon. In that case, it's trivial. Because what you can do is you simply pick every vertex in the projection. For that vertex, there must be a vertex in four dimensions that projects onto it, right? A vertex in the projection is a projection of a vertex. So pick a vertex in four dimensions. So you go around, pick vertices, and then you just connect with a line segment. Since F is convex, the line segment lies in F, and you have a continuous curve in four dimensions that will project exactly on this convex curve here. Okay? That was easy. And now we thought, now we just do a simple limit argument and we get the statement for arbitrary convex shapes. And maybe you can, but we were not able to make this go through. In fact, it turns out to be much harder, at least I don't see any easy way to prove it. So what's the statement? You have that compact convex shape F in four dimensions. It projects down to a compact convex shape in two dimensions. And you want to argue that there is actually a closed curve on the silhouette of F that projects to the boundary of P. When I first thought about it, isn't that obvious? The answer is, well, not really. So what can happen is, you take a spiral, let's say like this, right? So a spiral like this. So this point lies vertically above this point, right? And now what I take the convex hull of this spiral, right? So that's clearly a convex set. And if you project it, you get the unit circle. But in fact, there is no way to project the unit circle back onto a closed curve here. But
wouldn't that missing segment correspond to moving at a fixed ST angle?
So now it gets a bit tricky, yeah? So the question is, what happens exactly with this vertical segment? The way I've been drawing the set here is actually I excluded this point here. Right, so then you get a nice convex set, but it's not compact because this point is missing. And so in our case, we know that F is compact, so this can't happen. So if I try to make this convex compact, well, then the picture would look like this, right? So this would be the boundary. So then indeed there is a curve that goes like this, but at some point you keep theta fixed and you move, you translate. We don't want that. So if you look at the statement of the theorem, it doesn't actually allow this. Right? Tau must be a continuous function of theta. You're not allowed to stop at some angle, translate, and continue.
But it would solve Bohr's claim.
Depending on how you define turning, yeah. So that's a bit... Okay. I'm not exactly sure how he defined it. In any way, I want something stronger. And, I mean, even trying to prove just this is not as easy as it seems, right? I mean, this is just a picture. You still need to prove that this would work.
So for you, when you turn this object, you shouldn't stop at any moment.
Exactly. You're not allowed to stop at any angle. You're rotating continuously and translating at the same time. Right? So this is an example of a set. If you take this spiral, including both endpoints, and then you take the convex hull, this is a counterexample to this. Right? It's compact and it's a compact convex set in three dimensions. If you project into two dimensions, you get a nice unit disk, but the boundary cannot be projected back onto the silhouette of this, and you can obtain a continuous curve in the sense that you can change the angle continuously. Right? So we need something more. Our shape F has other properties. And the critical property that we need has exactly to do with these segments here. So if you add one more condition, namely if the pre-image of every boundary point is unique, so that means you never have a whole segment that projects to one point. Right? If this does not happen, then it follows simply from compactness arguments. The difficulty is exactly handling these segments. And the way we did that is to go back to the original problem statement. P, a rotated copy of P lies inside Q. So if you have a whole segment for a fixed angle, that means you can actually translate the object inside Q. So that gives you some specific geometry. And we showed actually that the length of this line segment is a continuous function of the angle. And if you then always pick the midpoint of this segment, then you get indeed a continuous function. Right, so in this picture it doesn't work because this segment suddenly appears. But what really happens in our application is that the segment somehow starts growing and then starts disappearing. And for everything you have a segment. And for instance, you can then use the midpoint of this to go around. So the details are a bit technical. You need to draw some pictures. So I will not show you how exactly that works. Any questions? Okay, then let me go back to this statement about the complexity of the projection. That's an interesting question actually, because it also tells you something about the complexity of this function tau and of the function lambda. Right? Lambda essentially is a boundary of the projection P. So if you know that the projection P has a certain complexity, that tells you something about the complexity of the function lambda, and by extension the function tau. And of course, if you want to compute this thing, you actually have to compute F and P. So this is the best bound that's known. And the question is, can we do better? All right, so proving in this paper from 20 years ago, Agarwal et al., they actually constructed convex polygons in the plane where this four-dimensional polytope has this complexity. Right? So they showed that this is indeed tight. You cannot improve this complexity bound. Right? There's a convex n-gon P and a convex n-gon Q such that this object F has this complexity. But on the other hand, in their paper, they also give a much simpler algorithm that computes the projection P, directly, without going through the four-dimensional object. And for that problem, their lower bound doesn't apply, because most of the vertices of this polytope F, they do not project onto vertices of P in the projection. Right? So this lower bound here, it's only for the four-dimensional polytope, not for the two-dimensional projection. Right? So we asked ourselves, is there perhaps some faster way to get the projection without going through the four-dimensional object? And after a lot of trial and error, we actually figured out no. In fact, we can construct convex polygons P and Q where the complexity of the projection is as big as the upper bound. So you win nothing by going from four dimensions back down to two. Actually, all the complexity in four dimensions could be on the silhouette. And so here's a short sketch of how this works. So let me first look at a simple case where P is simply the equilateral triangle. Right? So here I have a few, I'm not sure, can you see these light blue lines? Those are equilateral triangles. That's my object P. Now I want to construct an n-gon Q that has many maximal placements of equilateral triangles inside. And by many, I mean quadratically many. Right? So I want an n-gon with n squared placements of a maximal equilateral triangle. So this is how I do it. Pick a fixed point R and rotate this equilateral triangle around it. Right? So C here is a circle of radius 1 around R. So let me start at the leftmost position. That's P0, Q0, R. So that's my leftmost equilateral triangle. And then I rotate it by a few degrees, maybe 5 degrees in total. And I get n plus 1 positions of this equilateral triangle. Right? So let me call these points here P0, P1, up to Pn. These are Q0, Q1, to Qn. And now I will construct my polygon Q from these points here. And also I put points on, again on a circle arc. This circle is again radius 1 around a point down here. And these points are very, 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 very close together. So much closer than the picture shows. I mean, if I was drawing it correctly, you wouldn't see anything. Right? They're really, really tiny distance from R. Now what you need to do to construct Q, you'll use R0 to Rn as vertices at the top. So there you make a convex chain. And at the bottom, you always take two consecutive P's and draw a line through them. Then you skip two points and you draw a line through two. Right? You do the same with Q. So you go through these two, skip two, go through two, skip two, and so on. Right? And now the Q is simply the intersection of these half planes defined this way. Right? So here these meet somewhere here and these go to the left and to the right. Now I want to show you that there are indeed n squared maximal equilateral triangles in this Q. So the trick is, when we did this, actually if you look at Pj here, so Pj matches with Qj here. They form an equilateral triangle with R. But here you can turn to the right and there is still some free vertex and then you hit another one. Here it's the other way around. You can rotate to the left and there's a free vertex. And then you hit the wall. Right? So now what I claim I can do, pick any of these Ri at the top and pick some Pj and Qj. Right? So Ri is very close to R. So again, there is an equilateral triangle that has Ri as a vertex, and that has a vertex very close to Qj and very close to Pj. Right? It's certainly close enough that it doesn't hit any of the walls here. Now, when you take this triangle, you can rotate it clockwise, and it will hit this edge here. You can rotate it counterclockwise, and it will hit this edge here. Right? So there is a limited range where you can rotate it. And if at any of the intermediate positions you try to extend these edges as much as you can, there must be some place where they become equally long. And then you get an equilateral triangle that somehow fits into this pocket and into this pocket, and it has one corner at Ri. And you can do this for every Ri and every Qj, well, skipping 4 every time. Right? So here, every fourth Q point gives you a corner, and there every R gives you a corner. So that means there's n squared equilateral triangles, and all of them are maximal. Right? They're locally constrained. You cannot grow them any further. Right? So this is interesting. Apparently, this wasn't known before, because there's a very old paper from the embryonal stage of computational geometry by De Pano et al. In some obscure, the Allerton Conference on Communications and something, where they showed how to find the largest equilateral triangle in a convex polygon. It's not very difficult, but it's quadratic time. And people have been wondering if this is the best you can do. There's still nothing better known. And now we have some idea of why this might be hard to beat. Because there's n squared candidates. Right? There could be n squared locally maximal equilateral triangles. But I promised you something even stronger. I promised you an m-gon and an n-gon so that you get m times n squared. And this is a very beautiful generalization of the previous picture. So we just make m equilateral triangles, and they all share a corner at the top. Right? So you have 1, u0, v0, this is v0, u0, v0. So this is one equilateral triangle. The last one is vm, um, this, and then you space them regularly in between, so there are m equilateral triangles. And well, if you fix the upper corner, you can rotate p until any one of these corners here fits into this pocket that we saw before in q. Right? So q is the same as before, but now everything happens in a very small range here. That's where all these p vertices and q vertices from before were. I'm waving my hands here. If you don't see it, you have to look at the paper. Right, essentially, the trick is that any one of these m triangles inside can play the role of my p in the previous construction, because I can simply rotate around the top corner, and there's enough space in Q to make this rotation happen. Okay, so now it seems I have more or less done everything, but I have more. So we were asking this question, you have P and you have Q and you want to rotate P inside Q, or maybe you just want to make the largest copy of P that can be turned inside Q. And now I have this beautiful algorithm, but the algorithm constructs some mysterious polytope in 4 dimensions, then projects into a different plane, namely the ST plane, and there it does some construction, and then we somehow mysteriously get the answer. And how do you explain that to a middle school student? Well, you can't. And so the question was, is there actually some more geometric way to look at this? I mean, what is actually the geometry? Can you understand that a bit better? And it turns out there is actually some very interesting geometry, so I don't want to keep that from you. Are you falling asleep? I'll keep it short and easy. Right, so we have this function lambda that maps the angle to the largest possible scaling for that angle. Right? What we want now is the global minimum of the function lambda. The global minimum of this function, that's the largest copy of P that can be fully turned inside Q. So what if instead of looking at the global minimum, we just look at the local minima? And now I'm restricting myself to an easy case. So P and Q are both triangles. Right? So what's the local minimum of lambda of theta? That is a theta such that lambda p theta is maximal in Q, so it's as large as you can make it for that orientation, but still you can turn it in both directions. Right? Because lambda is a minimum, so around it's at least as large. So there's some neighborhood where you can still turn. So what does it mean to be maximal in Q? Well, that means you can think about it as a linear program. Right, you have lambda x and y as variables, and you have a maximal solution here. So there must be three constraints satisfied with equality. So that means either a vertex of P is on a vertex of Q, or each vertex of P is on an edge of Q. Right? The first case is actually very simple. If you have a triangle Q and you have another triangle P, and they have coinciding vertices, and P is as large as you can make it for this orientation. Well, that means that this point is on an edge. But clearly, this one cannot rotate it both ways, right? If you try to rotate P clockwise, it will crash into this edge. Right? So the only case where this is possible, a vertex on a vertex and a vertex on an edge, is if P is actually looks like this, and this is a right angle. Right? In that case, you can indeed rotate P around, simply around this point. So that's that means one of the edges of P is actually a height of Q. So that's a limited number of cases. We can look at them carefully and figure out which one is the best. So it remains to look at this one here. Right? So we have Q, a triangle, and we have P that touches each of the edges of Q. But it can still be turned in both ways. Right? So this is Q. This is P. It's clearly maximal. Right? You cannot scale it up and stay inside Q anymore. But is it turnable in both directions? Well, how do you see that? What's the geometric construction to see that? Now, the secret is you draw these pink lines, which are no longer pink on the screen. So you draw orthogonals through each of the touching points. Right? So these lines are orthogonal to the edges of Q through the touching points. Now, these three lines, they define an arrangement in the plane. It has a bounded face in the middle here. Let me put a point here. And now what I do is I rotate P around F clockwise. So then what happens, I should have brought a pointer. So what happens if you look at this point here? Well, we are rotating around F. So where does this point go? It goes outside Q. Right? Because and the same is true for that one, right? F is here, you look that way, you rotate the outside Q. The same happens there, right? F there, it goes outside Q. So what happens is that you get a congruent copy of P that has all three corners outside Q. And that means it's too big. There's no way to translate back into Q. Right? So this object is not turnable. So what did I exploit? I exploited the fact that I could put this point F in this bounded face here. So what must happen for P to be turnable? Yeah, the three normals must intersect in a point. Right? So there must not be this bounded face here. They must be intersecting in a point. Right? So now, and what does that mean, of course? If they intersect in a point, then the center of rotation around which you are turnable is that intersection. Right? And the contact points are the projections on the edges. Right? So we can reformulate the problem in the following way. Find the point F inside Q such that if you project F on the sides of edge, on the edges of F, of Q, okay, projecting F on the edges of Q will give you a triangle that's similar to P, a rotated and scaled copy. Right, so here's a point, project, and draw the triangle, and you want to find one which is similar to the given P. Now, how do you do that? Well, back to middle school. So this is what we want to achieve. Let me call this triangle UVW. Now you observe FVA is a right angle. That means that this point lies on the Thales circle through A and F, and so does U. Right? And that means that actually the length of UV can be expressed by the diameter of the circle and the angle at A. Right? And now you do the same thing for the other two sides, so you get that VW can express by the distance from B to F and this angle, and same for the one above. But these here should be the sides of a triangle similar to P. So that means we know what their ratio should be. The angles here are given. That means we are now given prescribed ratios for the distances AF, BF, and CF. Right? So that what you need to do is, given a triangle APC, find a point F such that these ratios are as given. And that is simply two Apollonius circles, or two, well, you draw two circles, the two circles that have the correct ratio. And that gives you a geometric construction for F. In case you want to explain this to a middle school student. Okay. Now, to round off the presentation, here I have a completely different problem, but it sounds cute, so I thought I would also show it to you. I'm given a triangle. So again, there's a triangle. And I want to pick a point, U, V, and W, one on each edge, such that the diameter of this point set, meaning the maximum of the three of these three edges, is as short as possible. Right? That's a problem statement. Given a triangle, put one point on each of its edges such that you minimize the diameter of the point set U, V, W. So first observation, it can't look like this. Right? So clearly here, UW is the unique longest edge. So you can simply move W to the left and make this one shorter. And then this one becomes longer. Right? So it can't be that there is a unique longest edge. The two longest edges must be equally long. So you have an isosceles. The solution must be isosceles. And I guess you can assume UV is equal to UW. And this is larger than VW. All right? And now it turns out if Q has a really large angle, like this, larger than 120 degrees, then the solution is take the angular bisector, call this point U, and then orthogonally project it on the other two sides. And call this V and W. It's easy to see that this is optimal because this is larger than 120 degrees, so this is less than 60. That means that VW is less than these two distances. Right? And these, of course, are equal because this is an angular bisector. And there cannot be any better solution, because if you put U here, then its distance to this line is too large. If you put U here, its distance to that line is too large. And once you have put U here, well, these two are the only ones that achieve this distance. So that's the correct solution. The question is, what if the largest angle in Q is less than 120 degrees, like this case here? And then it turns out the answer is actually it's the smallest equilateral triangle that can touch all three edges of Q. Right? So in that case, all three edges of U, V, W must be equally long. You are touching all the sides. So it's actually the smallest equilateral triangle that touches all edges of Q. But it turns out it's also the largest equilateral triangle that can be fully rotated inside Q. The problem we just solved before for the special case of the equilateral triangle. So we can construct it using our Apollonius circle construction. Right? So now UV, the three sides are equally long. So that gives us the following ratios for the side lengths for the distances AF, BF, and CF. And this turns out this is a known triangle center. It's called the first isodynamic point. So it's a unique point in a triangle. Sorry, it's a unique point in the circumcircle of a triangle such that if you project on the three edges, you get an equilateral triangle. And there are other characterizations. Okay, so this was to round off the presentations. Here are two open problems if you want to continue working on this. So as I said, Agarwal, Armenta, and Sharia, they actually have a nice simple algorithm to compute the projection P that doesn't need to do constructions in 4D. But it's not clear how to make use of that. If you only have P, well, you get the function lambda. But to construct the function tau, for every vertex in the projection, you need a vertex in 4D to get the translation. And you need to get all these translations. And I don't know any faster way to read this off than to construct F. Second question is, can you generalize this here to 4-gons, 5-gons, 6-gons? I think for 4-gons, it's not so difficult, but already for 6-gons, I have no idea how to solve this optimization problem, except to write down a quadratic program and plug it into a solver. And that's the end of my talk.